When it comes to my list of the top five things worth discussing in episode 3 of Westworld, aka The Stray, number one spins directly out of a question posed by Jonathan Nolan himself after the episode. And that's whether or not the hosts are genuinely gaining artificial intelligence, waking up, so to speak, or if an outside entity is responsible for the change in their behavior. Now, of course, that's been the question since episode one, but we were led to believe that while the characters in the show thought there was it was actually most likely that an outside entity was responsible for the change or, a programming glitch, of course the robots actually were waking up. This was another Rise of the Robot story, right? But tonight, in episode 3, a new wrinkle was introduced, and that, of course, is Arnold, Robert Ford's formerly silent founder when it came to Westworld. And with Jonathan Nolan's question, that caused me to revisit a question of my own for this show, and that is, who is God in Westworld? And some fascinating, mind-blowing revelations came out of this, so allow me to share. All right, so I think that right now we have three choices for who is God in Westworld. And that actually reminds me a little bit of the Holy Trinity. I think there's actually very strong religious connotations going on here, which you would not expect from a sci-fi show. Maybe you would, but not particularly from the Nolans. I mean, I don't think they've ever been very big on religious iconography or whatever. All right. So anyway, let me spell this out. So your number one choice is Anthony Hopkins. Duh, he's God in Westworld. Then the next choice is Jeffrey Wright. And I think that this episode goes a long way towards debunking the theory that he himself is a host. And then I was like, does that make Jeffrey Wright the son of God? Is he the Jesus of Westworld? And then I was like, no, I don't think he's taking on the suffering and hatred of mankind, as Jesus, of course, did. But then I instantly thought of what Robert Ford once again reiterated during this episode, and that's that his creations, his hosts, take on all that evilness from man, and that's their burden. And I'm like, are the hosts all Jesus? That's crazy, but it would work. And then, of course, there's Arnold. Would he be the Holy Spirit of this Trinity, right? I believe he's the voice we hear at the end tell Dolores to finally kill. Of course, her programming previously wouldn't allow her to. At first, I thought it was Jeffrey Wright's voice, but I've listened to it several times, and I don't believe that it is. So if this is Arnold telling everybody what to do, right, as we're being led to believe, I think there are still even some more questions about that. I don't think that's even so clear-cut. One is that Arnold didn't die, right? Is he still real, right? The other is that he is an artificial intelligence that he downloaded into Westworld to give it, you know, that's like how he created artificial intelligence, borrowing a page from Transcendence. Actually, interestingly enough, which is in the Nolan, verse to some degree, because Wally Pfister, their celebrated cinematographer, or Christopher Nolan's celebrated cinematographer, of course, directed that movie. That was supposed to be his big break. It didn't turn out that way. But so maybe Arnold downloaded himself into the Westworld hosts to finally achieve that artificial intelligence that was so elusive to him. And then, this was what really blew my mind. I was like, what if Ford has created Arnold, and this is a meta-narrative. Maybe his new narrative goes beyond the Westworld theme park into the offices, right? Can a narrative that Ford creates go beyond the confines of the stage, so to speak, right? The staging area. And that I thought was crazy. And I thought that would be an interesting idea if Ford was like, everyone's gonna play my new storyline. And I'm like, oh, he's so crazy. Why does he have no oversight? All right, let's go to the second thing. And that, of course, is Anthony Hopkins, who feels a little bit like he's malfunctioning, right? If he were a host, you'd be like, we need to send him to be diagnosed stat. Now, the funniest thing in the episode with him to me, he had two major moments, I felt. One, I have to talk about it, was when he yelled at that other guy who worked there about covering up the host. I was like, I feel like Anthony Hopkins is directly talking to me. I was like, whoa, and he was so upset about it and so intense, which I'm sure, of course, speaks to something going on within his character. But it was just like, I was really rattled, just like the individual he was talking to. I was like, okay, I'll sit here with them naked. Jeez, it was crazy. And they chopped up that guy's face. I was like, whoa. It was really funny. It was almost like the show itself Randolph was reaching through the screen and talking to anybody who had a problem with the nudity of the characters, right? And it was almost like it was annoyed and had to explain it. It's like, it's obvious. And I'm like, I still don't like this nudity and I think it's disrespectful to the actors. And they're like, get over it. All right. And then also we have to talk about young Anthony Hopkins. That was amazing use of visual effects. They try and de-age actors all the time these days. Robert Downey Jr. in Civil War, back with X-Men The Last Stand, with Ian McKellen and Patrick Stewart, and it really hasn't been very effective, but this was jaw-droppingly amazing. I was like, oh my god. Now, part of me felt they just scanned Anthony Hopkins from one of his older movies, because he's been working for quite a long time, long before he became a household name. And so I thought that that might have played into it. But also, they lucked out that in this shot, he wasn't really doing anything. He was just standing still with one emotion, right? They didn't have to show a range of emotions. He didn't have to move around. And so I think that benefited them in selling the shot. But still, with all those, even with all those asterisks, it's amazing. It was an amazing technological feat, and it blew my mind. All right. So that's the second thing. The third thing is Dolores. I'm starting to see what the point of Dolores is, and that is that she is obviously our Alice in Wonderland. They also made that super clear. And suddenly I was like, oh yeah, the long flowing blonde hair, the blue dress. Hello, Alice. Although I thought that the wig for Evan Rachel Wood was really not really well maintained this episode. There were a number of shots where I was like, your hair looks horrible. Like, for the first two episodes, it looked perfect. And maybe this is intentional. Maybe Alice is like, you know what? I'm not going to wash my robot hair anymore. F you, everybody. You know, they're like, have you seen Dolores lately? She looks like she, you know, she's like really, you know, taking a feminist stand. She's like, I'm going to wear it all crazy. And I'm aware that my hair is, the humidity has done a little bit of a number on my hair today as well. But I'm not a host, right? So anyway, I thought that was hilarious. But the only problem with having Alice, the Alice in Wonderland motif, is that that's like remedial fantasy. Like, whenever anyone dabbles in fantasy, they're like, I know, I'll do Alice in Wonderland, right? So many people have done it, and like so many people continue to do it. Like, I think the first couple of times it was inventive. You're like, oh, wow, you know, like Resident Evil to some degree plays with this. But, you know, today, it's like, again, when anyone decides to dabble in fiction and, you know, creating fantasy, so often they go to Alice in Wonderland. And I bring that up because I would think that HBO and a Nolan, Jonathan, even if he is not Christopher Nolan, should be a little bit beyond that at this point. So if they're going to go with the Alice in Wonderland theme, they got to make sure they do it better than like almost anyone else to justify something that's just, I think, overused at this point. But I did think that Evan Rachel Wood did a very good job with her acting this episode. She had to do a lot of switching in and out between, you know, modes, you know, game mode, analytical mode, etc. You know, all the emotions she's wrestling with. I thought she handled it really well. And just by the expression on her face and the way she was acting, you could tell what level she was in. And that's impressive. So kudos to her. And, you know, I think Evan Rachel Wood is miscast as a farmer's daughter, right? This Alice in Wonderland. But I think she's very well cast as someone having all these complex emotions. So as that starts to happen, I think the role is a better fit with her. Then I have to say, speaking of her programming, damn, it's good. When she fainted in White Hat Jimmy Simpson's arms at that campfire, I was like, that's how you seduce. Take notes, Tandy Newton. Your stupid speech isn't working, but that's going to really work. And I think it's, I don't know if, you know, her programming was still at play somehow, right? Because, you know, she has been given a personality. I think, was she still on improv when she left Jeffrey Wright? But it's still in there. And I was like, whoever programmed Dolores, it really was a work of art. And I wonder if Robert Ford programmed her personally. But that was fantastic. I was like, he'll never get her out of his head now. It's amazing. And speaking of hosts, number four, James Marsden. I liked seeing that same story play out, you know, of the reunion of Dolores and Teddy, right? But with both of their personalities being altered and how that was changing the conversation. A couple of times you could see the reaction on his face was almost like, that's not what you're supposed to say, Dolores. But of course, I don't think the other lines are programmed to them. It would be interesting to see how, if someone does go off book, how does the other host react? I guess they switch to improv mode too, right? But I thought that was really interesting. And suddenly his blandness as a host works. You know, he's that bland male hero, although I think that Robert Ford is obviously adding some spice. But what I thought was really hilarious about the interaction between Teddy and Dolores this episode was when she caught on to what someday means. She was like, someday doesn't mean tomorrow or next week. It means probably never. And I was like, that's hilarious that they're having this Teddy host give out standard guyisms, things that guys say all the time, right? In real life. But Dolores, even though she's an adult, because she's not programmed to, she hasn't learned these things, things that almost all women learn, you know, in puberty, right? So that was hilarious. I mean, I think in another episode, I would love it if Dolores was like, you know, Teddy, I think you don't actually care about how my day was. I mean, it was like that level. It was just really funny. And then the final thing that I want to talk about is a slight negative about the show. Actually, I think the show is interesting, and as you can see, it certainly has me thinking, but I think that from a business standpoint, this show has a serious flaw, and that's what I want to discuss as the final thing today. Now, when I wrote my comic book, and I was doing the outline for the episode, Superbia, at the top of my notes, I always, so I could see it, every time I glanced at them, I wrote action, sex, and violence, because I knew that every issue, and I was inspired by this from watching HBO, actually, and I was like, you need these three things to keep your audience hooked, right? Especially in today's entertainment world. Not in everything, like Stranger Things does, you know, Stranger Things though does have action, you know, the promise of sex and violence as well. But anyway, you know, it's obviously to varying degrees, but those elements need to be there to some degree. This show doesn't have that. They don't check the boxes every episode. And I think that the strongest thing it has going for it is this very cryptic and slow mystery. So I actually thought last night that I wished that I could watch all of the Westworld episodes right now. And this was the first HBO show I've seen where I was like, you know, this should be a binge show. You should have released all the episodes at once and let me just burn through it because I really just want to find out what's going on. And I think that I wrote in my notes here that what Westworld is missing is water cooler moments. There's no reason to tune into this on Sunday night. You don't have to worry about coming into school or the office or just seeing friends and having them ruin something exciting because no one's going to be like, man, did you watch Westworld last night? What'd you think of that conversation about free will? You know, it's just not a big conversation starter. I mean, I think people are probably thinking a lot about internally, and if you know the other person's watching the show, you know, maybe you'll talk about it, but no one's gonna like run up and blurt something out to the point where you can't be like, stop, I didn't watch it last night. I'm gonna watch it, we'll talk about it then. And that's, I think, the biggest problem that Westworld has, which is gonna keep it from becoming the type of show that HBO needs it to be. I also felt that it was a horrible waste of Neil Marshall to direct this episode. He's a set piece guy. He's directed some of the most famous and spectacular episodes of Game of Thrones. When you watch Game of Thrones and you're like, this should be a movie, it's because largely because Neil Marshall directed it. They swapped him out for a new guy this last season with the Battle of the Bastards, and that guy won an Emmy. But still, Neil Marshall certainly has a reputation. And so I think to bring him on for an episode which didn't have any big set pieces was, you know, you should use the right tool for the job. That's a saying for a reason, and Neil Marshall was not the right tool for this episode. So I hope they start getting some water cooler moments soon, or I don't see Westworld being like a big, you know, sexy hot show. I don't see it being like one of the big shows that everybody talks about. It could still live on as this really strong intellectual show that HBO really believes in. Maybe it'll be a big awards winner. But in terms of a show that like lights the internet on fire and is the most pirated show ever, I don't see that happening just quite yet. So what did you think of episode 3 of Westworld? What are your theories? Who do you think is God? What do you think of my, you know, the religious aspects that I'm starting to pick up on? Do you think I'm right? And then also, what do you think of the Alice in Wonderland theme? And also this idea that the show needs water cooler moments. Write your thoughts down below, and you can check out some more episodes right now.